Good morning. Morning. Welcome to worship service this morning, the celebration of our Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ, and that he has laid down his life for us and been raised up again so that we have new life in him. We do have a nursery available today if you have young children under the age of 4. Also, we are celebrating communion this day, Jesus Christ's very body and blood for our forgiveness of sins. And so if you're not familiar or part of our Lutheran fellowship of our church or the LCMS, you can always come forward and cross your arms for a blessing during communion for our table today. We will be doing communion today in the table format with a dismissal after each table. I'll make another announcement throughout the service. If you would, please rise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Let us greet one another with the peace of Christ.
Your love is greater, your love is stronger.
Jesus said, "If anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. If anyone serves me, the Father will honor him."
Speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into Him who is the head, into Christ.
To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust.
Indeed, none who wait for you shall be put to shame.
Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation.
All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his testimonies.
Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, from everlasting to everlasting.
Let us confess our sins to God, our Heavenly Father. O Lord God, Almighty, we confess that we are sinful human beings by nature and by deed.
We have not put you first at all times. We have not followed in the ways you have set forth for us. We have not always been thoughtful caretakers of your creation and have not shared its bounty in all our occasions. We have not kept our thoughts, words, and deeds fully pure and honorable. We have sinned in ways we know, and in ways we do not even recognize. We have not honored those in authority, and have not allowed conversation to encourage them. We have not completely given the best instruction on all things, and on all people. Have mercy on us, O Lord. Forgive us
The Almighty and Merciful Lord, grant us pardon, forgiveness, and remission of all of our sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by His authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Be with you.
And also with you.
We pray. Risen and ascended Lord, you are the good shepherd. You lay down your life for the sheep. They are yours. Empower your church to reach every sheep that belongs to you and to give witness until you have brought all your sheep into one fold. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for our readings.
Good morning. I'm Desiree, and the first reading is written in Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 12. And as they were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, greatly annoyed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. On the next day, their rulers and elders and scribes gathered together in Jerusalem with Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander and all who were of the high priestly family. And when they had set them in the midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given by men by which we must be saved." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The second reading is written in 1 John chapter 3, verses 16 through 24. "By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and seen his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. By this we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our heart before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God, and whatever we ask, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he has commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Able in reverence to the words of our Lord. The Holy Gospel according to St. John in the 10th chapter. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a robber and a thief. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all of his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, and they do not know the voice of strangers. This figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus said again to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is hired, a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated, and I would like to invite the young children to come forward for a special message from Michelle.
Good morning. Good morning. How are we doing this morning? Good. Do you know the story of the three little pigs? Raise your hand if you know the story. Okay. I'm going to tell it to you in case some of these grown-ups haven't ever heard it. Okay? But I'm going to ask you to help me tell the story, okay? Boys, whenever you hear me say the word pig, I want you to oink like a pig. Okay? Girls, when you hear me say the word wolf, I want you to howl like a wolf. And all of you, when you hear the word sheep, I want you to baa like a sheep. Got it? Okay, practice for me. And our sheep? Baa. Okay, ready? The story begins with the mother pig sending her three little pigs out into the world to make their own fortunes. The first pig built himself a house of straw. The second pig built a house of sticks. And the third pig built a house of bricks. The big bad wolf went to the first little pig's house and knocked on the door. Little pig, let me in, he said. The little pig answered, not by the hair of my chinny chin chin. Then I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house in, replied the wolf. All right, guys, you may have to help them. The first little pig house was made of straw. It was not very strong. So the wolf easily blew it down. And the little pig ran to safety at his brother's house. The second little pig, his house is made of sticks. And the wolf came and said, little pig, let me in. And the pig replied, not by the hair of my chinny chin chin. So I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house in, replied the wolf. The second little pig's house of sticks was not very strong. So the wolf blew it down and the two little pigs ran to their brother's house. The wolf went to the third little pig's house and knocked on the door. Little pig, let me in. The little pig answered, not by the hair of my chinny chin chin. Then I'll huff and I'll puff and I'll blow your house in, replied the wolf. No matter how hard he tried, the wolf could not blow the brick house down. The wolf decided to go down the chimney. But the little pigs had a plan for that too. They had a pot of boiling water. Yow! Cried the wolf. Having outsmarted the big bad wolf, the three little pigs began to sing. Who's afraid of the big bad wolf? The big bad wolf. The big bad wolf. Who's afraid of the big bad wolf? Tra-la-la-la-la. So, this was kind of a silly story, wasn't it? Yeah, a very silly story. Did you know that there are stories in the Bible about a big bad wolf?
Yeah.
Yeah? What other stories do we know? There's a story about Peter and the wolf. There's a story about Little Red Riding Hood and the boy who cried wolf. But did you know that Jesus once told a story about a big bad wolf? In that story, Jesus told, the good shepherd is him, and the sheep are us. The wolf, in Jesus' story, is God's enemy. Here's what Jesus said in the Bible. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for his sheep. A hired hand will run away when he sees a wolf, because the sheep don't belong to him, and he doesn't really care about them. When the hired hand runs away, the wolf will attack and scatter the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. I will lay down my life for my sheep. Jesus is the good shepherd, and we are his sheep. He knows us, and he loves us. He will protect us when God's enemy or anyone tries to hurt us. When we trust Jesus, we can say, who's afraid of the big bad wolf? Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for sending your Son to be our good shepherd. He gave his life for us. Help us to follow him and trust him to protect us from the evil one. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, our good shepherd, who gives us his very word so that we might listen to him and follow him. Amen. From the gospel text today for the Good Shepherd Sunday, I'll read a few verses from 2 and 3 and then 10 and 11. Jesus is speaking, "To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." So far our text. Hopefully, you have been coming to my Bible study these last few weeks because we have been having the theme of shepherd and sheep. And Good Shepherd Sunday is a theme in the church year and a theme for the worship service of Jesus Christ, our Good Shepherd. Happens all the time after Easter on a certain Sunday. And this analogy goes all the way throughout Scripture. So just to be aware of, we kind of know it. I mean, when we hear a clever children's message or we hear pictures or see pictures of Jesus Christ, we see him as a shepherd. We know about sheep. Christians have this. This is an analogy that we have all throughout Scripture and in our lives. We kind of grow up this way. But it's a little weird of an analogy that God would use. In my Bible study a couple weeks previous, I asked the question, why this? Why would he choose a shepherd? Why would he choose sheep? What is going on with this analogy? Because it really applies to us today. And we're going to dig into the text, into the gospel. The first thing that many people realize, and if you've been with animals, you understand this intimately. If you have not, you've heard the stories. One of the reasons why God calls us sheep is that we have a problem. We have an ignorance issue, possibly, or sheep are just kind of dumb. Yes, that's what God calls us, lovingly. Says you just don't quite get it. And it's not dumb like they're not intellectual. It's dumb that they just don't do the right thing. They just don't get it. They need a shepherd all the time. There's an ignorance, if you would, of it. Or maybe a stubbornness. Or a sheep that just doesn't want to listen or doesn't want to follow, which you can apply to your own lives. A joke about dumb sheep. There was a sheep that was found in a pit one time. He's trying to get his shepherd's attention. And the sheep cried out, "Baa! Baa!" Louder even, "Baa! Come help me. Come get me out of the pit." And after a while, another sheep had heard this sheep bleeding and fell into the pit too. Now we talk about dumb sheep. Now you have two dumb sheep down at the bottom of the pit. And the first one goes, "Baa," and the second one goes, "Baa," and they go back and forth, "Baa, baa." It sounds like they're a lot, just two down there, lonely, waiting for their shepherd. And the first sheep has an idea. And he says, "You know, if we cried out together, we might get his attention." And the second sheep says, "That's a good idea." So they start up, and they say, "Together, together." Yeah, it's dumb, but that's kind of the point. The point is that the sheep just don't quite get it. They don't quite listen appropriately of what's going on, and we're going to focus a little bit about that today, of listening of the sheep. They are kind of dumb. They don't get what the shepherd says, and in fact, in the text, Jesus Christ is using an analogy, and it's somewhat complex, but for the people of the time and the day, as where they're at in the context, they kind of get it, some of them, but it says in the text, they're like, "I don't know what you're talking about with shepherds and sheep," so Jesus has to use a number of analogies with shepherd and sheep, trying to get them to understand their need for the good shepherd and who he is as the good shepherd. The sheep have this problem of not understanding. And so the good shepherd comes in and says an analogy with the sheep and says, "I want to live with you. You're not just a product. You're not just money on the hoof, if you would, or on the foot. You're not just wool, something that I'm going to take in or slaughter myself. I'm going to come in and live with you, sheep who need a shepherd. Because you're scared, because you're at the bottom of a pit, because you don't understand, because you're ignorant, because you're selfish, because you're scattered. I want to live with you and be your good shepherd. I want to have my very voice and presence be with you." A good shepherd does this. A good shepherd who takes care of his sheep will be in the midst of his sheep so they know him. And I've seen this. Amazing things with a shepherd where for 4-H or FFA or even out in the field, because they've been with them so often, the shepherd will come into the barn or go out into the field and go, "Hey, sheep!" And they'll perk up their ears and they'll go listen to them. And you go, "Wait a second, I thought they were dumb. I thought they don't get it. I thought they don't listen real well." Like, yes, they listen because the shepherd's with them. The shepherd's doing it all the time. The shepherd is inside and out from baby all the way to aged. The shepherd says, "Listen to my voice. I love you. I'm with you. I would not say something that would be detrimental to you. I would not say something that would hurt you. I would not say something that would harm you. I am your shepherd. I am your good shepherd." Are you listening to the good shepherd? He has words for you. Now, many words we like. We love this passage. We want a good shepherd. We want somebody who loves us. Some words we don't quite like because we're dumb sheep when the shepherd says, "Don't go out that way." Now, sheep should say, "I love my shepherd. My shepherd loves me. I want to listen to his voice. I want to go in and out with him. I don't want to be by myself." But we kind of are dumb sheep. We're sinful sheep. We're stubborn sheep. And so the shepherd says, "I want you to listen over and over again. I want you to hear my word. I want you to hear God's word. I want you to hear that this is the best place for you. I want you to know that you are loved." Sheep have some other problems as well. Maybe not ignorance or lack of listening, but we have the problem of being self-absorbed. We look at ourselves and bleed at ourselves, and this happens in flocks. You'll get sheep, and one will start bleeding, blah, 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 and another one will start bleeding just for the heck of it. And all of a sudden, the sheep are all in a stir because they're talking to themselves and it's all about them. I've seen it happen. I've seen sheep get scattered very easily, not even when there is an enemy around, because it's all about them. It's all about their needs. It's all about their hurt, their hunger. Now, granted, they have some legitimate needs, but oftentimes it's imaginary. They're fearful. They're anxious. They get scattered, and Jesus comes into Jerusalem even by the temple and says, "I want to be your good shepherd. I am your good shepherd. Stop being so self-absorbed. Stop being sheep that are so easily scattered, that listen to so many others. They get frightened by the thieves and the robbers and the wolf and don't know where their shepherd is at and wander around and even hurt themselves and harm themselves." My question for you is, do you realize that you're self-absorbed? How does your state in life compare? And I've run into this as well, that the shepherd and the sheep sometimes are far apart from each other because the sheep want it that way. You think it's all about you. Shepherd, come do what I want. And the shepherd's like, "No, I'm your good shepherd. I will give you what you need, sometimes even what you want, but listen to me." And you go, "No, I want to listen to my voice. I want to listen to the voice of the sheep. I want to listen to the voice of the world. I don't want to listen to the shepherd's voice." That's what we call sin. We have a problem with that. It's our problem, not the shepherd's problem. It's our problem, not the word's problem. It's our problem, not the church's problem. It's our problem, the sheep. It's all about us. It's all about our sin. It's all about our wants. And the shepherd says, "Please listen to my voice." That's how the shepherd combats sheep that are self-absorbed, that are buying to themselves, that are always about what they're doing. The shepherd comes in and says, my very presence is here, but I want you to listen. And he does it calmly, but he does it over and over. He trains the sheep and says, "You are my sheep and I love you. I feed you appropriately. You come in and go out of pasture. I love you. Listen to my voice. It is gentle. It is calm. It is loving. And I'm going to speak it over and over and over again so that you get it. Instead of being self-absorbed and listening to everything else, you start listening to the shepherd. And this is a lifetime kind of gig, folks. It's not a once and done. Well, I heard the gospel today, so I'm done. I can do whatever I want. I'm like, no, That's a self-absorbed sheep. It's a, I heard the gospel today, and 15 minutes later, I'm like, I need to hear the gospel again. I have my thoughts, I have my actions, I have my activities that are all drawing me away from the shepherd. And you know, older sheep, how difficult this is in your life, right? You know, as you get older in life, you start to realize, I need my shepherd more and more. I need his voice. And how I wish I would have listened to his voice when I was 20. How I wish I would have listened to his voice when I first started my family. How I wish I would have listened to his voice more when we were being raised up. We have the age of wisdom of sheep that said, yes, I realize what it means to be a sinful, selfish sheep, and I want to be close to my shepherd. I want to be in church. I want to be in Bible study. I want to be in his word. I want to be with the sacrament. I want to be close and hear what he says, because what he says is good. He loves us. He's our good shepherd. He feeds us. So not only do you have the self-absorbed and the ignorance problem of sheep, there's also another problem of sheep, and we mentioned it slightly. And I want to say it's probably a more prevalent problem among Lutheran Christians. We're just too stubborn. Ever been called that? Now, not stubborn in a good way. That's steadfastness. So I tell people that. You can be stubborn in a good way. That's being steadfast. It's doing the right thing and continuing to do the right thing. Great. No, stubborn in the bad way is, I'm just going to do it because we've always done it that way. Or I'm just going to do it because that's the way I feel. Or I'm just going to do it because I'm going this way and I don't care. It's me, me, me. Stubborn sheep. Yeah, we laugh at it with our kids, right, when they're stubborn? We laugh at it when we see animals out. When they're stubborn, you're like, oh man, they just won't go in. They won't go in and find pasture. They're just locking their legs. They don't want to do these things. But we don't laugh when it's applied to us, right? When we get too stubborn in our sin, we start to like it, and we start to get bitter, and we get self-justified. That's how usually you can tell a stubborn person. They will justify themselves as opposed to looking at God's word and what Christ has done and being justified by him. They will get stubborn in their ways, in their works, and that's usually what happens with us sheep, is that we will start to say, hey, it's about what we do, about what we think, about what we feel. It's us. It's the sheepocentric church, not Christocentric. And our world is getting that way more and more. Christianity. Lutherans. Christians who were steadfast at one time, but now are stubborn in their sin. And the Good Shepherd comes in and says, I still love you. I still care for you. I don't want you to be calcified and stubborn in your sin. I will go and find you. In fact, that's another parable in Luke, where the shepherd goes out and finds the sheep and says, you've been so stubborn. You've been wandering off. You've been so ignorant. You've been so self-absorbed. Now you're lost. Now you're going to be hurt. Now you're going to be destroyed. And I will pick you up. I will bring you back to the flock so you're safe with the shepherd again. And then he does one thing more here in John. He says, you know, you have your enemies out there. Not only do I care for the sheep and I want them to be in one fold, but if the enemy is harassing you so badly, I'm going to lay down my life for you. I'll let the wolf tear at me and not you. I will let the thief come in and steal what is mine and not you. I will let the robber come in and empty my purse and not you. This is what it means to be a good shepherd. This is what blows their mind as they're listening, and our mind too. Normal shepherds don't do this. Normal people don't do this. Yes, you might do it for a friend or a loved one, maybe once or twice, or if you're in the military for your comrades, but for a stranger, would you die? For an enemy? For a stubborn sheep? A sinful sheep? Would you do that for just a little animal? And the shepherd says, I'm the good shepherd. I'll do it for you. And I'm also going to do it for you. I'm going to do it for you. And I'll do it for you. And I'll do it for all you. And I'll do it for the world. So that you can be in one flock. So that you can be protected from your biggest enemy of sin, death, and the devil. That you could have new life, that the good shepherd will lay down his life for the sheep. And then he gives a little gospel clue in here, which is awesome. Not only does he talk about the cross, but then he says, I'll take up my life again. My Father has given me authority and He will raise me up again. He lets His disciples know. He lets the people know. That's not the end of the story. The Good Shepherd's not about just dying and then the sheep are just left alone. The Good Shepherd is about dying and rising. Dying for your sins and the enemy, yourself, and rising to new life to say you have new life. Not just a spiritual new life. Eternal new life in Christ. Your sins are washed away. You're forgiven this day. Your enemy has no claim on you. He's outside the flock. You have a good shepherd present with you today. He says, listen to me. I want to comfort you. I want to give you good news. I want to give you the news that you are safe among the flock, that you are satisfied, that you're taken care of, that you listen to the good shepherd's voice, and then you follow him because you say, that's my Savior. That's my shepherd. That's the good shepherd. I want to read the text again. Jesus is speaking. He says, but he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Amen. And may Jesus Christ, our good shepherd, always be present with us. And may we always have his word and sacrament, knowing that we are fed by him and in his flock. Amen. We continue at this time with our offering. Please rise. We confess the first article. As our good shepherd leads us, even so our heavenly Father hears the prayers of his people. Assured of his fatherly care, let us speak together the words of the Apostles' Creed regarding the first person of the Holy Trinity. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. What does this mean? I believe that God has made me and all creatures, that he has given me my body and soul, eyes, ears, and all my members, my reason and all my senses, and still takes care of them. He also gives me clothing and shoes, food and drink, house and home, wife and children, land, animals, and all I have. He richly and daily provides me with all that I need to support this body and life. He defends me against all danger and guards and protects me from all evil. All this he does with fatherly, divine goodness and mercy, without any merit or worthiness in me. For all this it is my duty to thank and praise, serve and obey him. This is most certainly true. We pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give you great thanks and praise this day for Jesus Christ, our Good Shepherd, who took on our worst enemies, ourself, the devil and the world, who died on the cross so that all of our sins would be washed away, and then rose again. And Lord, we thank you for the Good Shepherd that would lay down his life for the sheep and be raised up again for us. And we would pray this day as your sheep, that you would help us to listen to your word, that you would overcome our fears and our anxiety, that you gather us together in Christ's presence with his word and sacrament and in his church. And Lord, we would ask that those sheep that we know that are straying, that we would be able to give the voice of the shepherd as well and share his comfort and peace. We would pray, Lord, that you be with our adult education and all of our education here. We pray, Lord, for our Sunday school, for us to be together, for our children and youth and our aged, that we might know and understand your word, that we might meet in our Bible studies and have personal devotions together. Lord, we pray for our sister church of Shepherd of the Springs. We ask, Lord, that your word would be present there and bold. We pray, Lord, for your guardian angels to watch over our communities, especially Village 7 and the Cimarron Hills neighborhoods, their schools, and their public servants. Lord, we thank you for Mercy's Gate and for Crossfire Ministries, and we ask, Lord, that these acts of mercy would reach out to those around us in our neighborhood and give them the gospel of Christ. We pray for the cessation of war, especially in Israel and Iran. We ask, Lord, that Ukraine would also be away from war and would recover. And Lord, that you would still conflict around the world and bring them peace, especially the peace of Christ. Lord, we pray for all of our servants, for our government servants in our towns and in our cities, in our state and in our nation. We pray for our medical workers and our military who guard and protect others. Please guard and protect them and give them your will. Lord, we would pray for the families and the communities, the schools and the teachers, all that were affected 25 years ago with the Columbine shooting. As we remember this anniversary, Lord, help us to be diligent, to be safe. Lord, help us to cling to you, because that is where only safety is found. And Lord, when violence happens, Lord, gather us together once again in your flock. We pray for Doris's sister, Carol, for a complete alleviation of pain. And we thank you, Lord, for your mercies and your miracles that you show us every day in answering our prayer. Please be with Betty Thomas, who is homebound, and many others. Allow us as the body of Christ to reach out to them in their time of need. Lord, we would pray for Ron and Ann. We pray for Nancy. We pray for Dan. We would ask, Lord, that you would be with them in their needs and be with them in their isolation and in their sadness. We would ask, Lord, that you would bind them up, be their good shepherd once again, give them closeness with Jesus Christ in his word and sacrament in the body of Christ, and comfort them. All of these things, Lord, we do ask in and through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and proper that we should give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, for in Jesus Christ you have shown your saving power and your great compassion. In amazing love, he sacrificed himself and shed his blood for the forgiveness of our sins. His unending love leads him to intercede for us as, aided by the Holy Spirit, he brings our cares to your throne of grace. Grant that we may live in humility, honoring our Savior in all that we do and rejoicing that we are granted a foretaste of the heavenly banquet. Pour out your Holy Spirit upon us that we may rejoice in the gifts before us and praise you with thankful hearts. Amen. Blessed be your name. In your great love, you sent your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be the promised Savior, whose power was shown in humble care and whose life of service fulfilled your will and completed the work of our salvation. With thankfulness, we receive the blessings he had obtained for us. Gather into one, we pray, you, all your people, who now join at your holy table. Bless and nourish us, so that all who partake of Christ's body and blood may be strengthened to serve you and our neighbor, as you would have us do. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. On the night our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, when he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, Jesus took the cup, and after supper and giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember and confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. This peace of the Lord be with you always. Today for communion, we will be having one table and a dismissal after each table. You will be ushered in from the middle to start with, and then on the ends, and then we will have our tables that we have. We sing.
Christ, true Lamb of God,
thank you.
pray. Gracious and eternal God, we thank you for having fed us with the body and blood of our Lord Jesus. Grant that the bread of life and the blood of Christ that has been shared and received in this blessed meal be for us that life-giving food that sustains us on our earthly journeys as we serve you all of our days. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Go out into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold to what is good. Return no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. The Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you. Amen. Please be seated. Just a few announcements for today. Thank you for bearing with a wonderful meal where the sheep are gathered all together and we're fed on Jesus Christ and his body and blood. Thank you for that. A few things. If you ordered an Easter lily, please, you may pick them up in room 120. We are still receiving online donations and some wonderful donations, too. Thank you very much for that. That is until the end of the month, donating online for Honduras and our special project for that. Today is the last order for butter braids for our youth. Please look at our youth after service to order online and on the link. Also, too, if you're interested, we have lots of opportunities at our ministry center, lots of activities and things coming up. Please see that at the ministry center. The Theology on Tap that meets will be meeting this Monday, not next Monday, this Monday at 6:30 p.m. at Trinity Brewing Company. And then also, too, afterwards, we will be having our Bible study here. We're going to give you plenty of time for fellowship, so don't worry about rushing in here. Enjoy some coffee, enjoy some donuts, and some fellowship time with each other. After that, we will start up our Bible study here about shepherding and sheep. May the Lord bless your day as well as your week. We sing.